Comic-Con. Thanks so much to be joining us here for the Sony Hall H panel. I'm very excited to present a ton of really awesome footage and questions and answers for you guys today. So I think we're gonna have a great time. We have lots of stuff to show you. So without further ado, let me introduce to you our Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse crew. We've got Rodney Rothman.
I did break my arm, yes.
And Phil Lord.
Yeah.
Thank you guys for joining us. How's Comic-Con been so far for you?
Great.
Excellent. Eventful.
Awesome.
Comic-Con.
All right, well, let's get right to it. Chris and Phil, why did you want to make this movie?
That's how every movie we make starts. look, you know, this story's been told a lot of times. We love Miles Morales. We thought that was an amazing way to tell the Spider-Man story. We fell in love with the book. And when Sony came to us and said, you know, we want to do an animated Spider-Man movie, we said, we'll do it, but it has to be Miles. And we started, yeah, give it up for Miles Morales. And then we got sort of carried away, and it kind of grew from there. But he's just an inspiring character. The whole idea is, how do we tell this story in a refreshing way? How do we tell it through somebody else's experience? How do we put a new spin on it? And Miles is a great start.
Well, the fact that you did approach it in a refreshing way, you did put a new spin on it, but then stylistically, it's also very unique looking. So how did you kind of combine those two in order to bring it to life?
Yeah, that was the other thing that we were really excited about. We felt like this is the best opportunity ever to tell a story that actually looked like a comic book, like you were literally walking into a comic book. So from the very beginning, we said, what can we do? How can we make a movie that looks like nothing you've ever seen before, that's like a completely unique cinematic experience that feels like you're walking into the pages of a three-dimensional comic book? And to everybody here's credit, these three geniuses over here, they were able to make it look like something you've never seen before and something that has to be seen on a big screen.
Yeah, I've gotten a chance to look at it, and I was telling them behind stage that it is absolutely phenomenal looking. I legitimately absolutely love it. It looks really cool. Why was Shamik the perfect Miles for you guys? Not to talk about him as if he's not here.
Well, don't tell him.
Okay, close your ears, Shamik.
We've been fans of Shamik for a long time. We loved him ever since we saw him for the first time in Dope. And we've known him for a while from different auditions and things, and we've always felt like this guy is brilliant. He's so sincere, he's funny, he's cool, he's everything that Miles is. He's got a really unique, like, positive take on life. This is his first Comic-Con, this is his first time he's been here. And from the beginning, we were like, this guy is the guy, and we were right.
Oh man, he's so nice. Smooth talk.
Shamik, what was it about playing Miles that really appealed to you in particular?
Well, you know, he's a black Spider-Man, black and Mexican. I think that that's very powerful and iconic. And yeah, I was thankful for the opportunity. The fact that it looks this beautiful and the fact that the writing is so amazing and that the cast is so amazing was a pleasant surprise. But the fact that I was able to have the opportunity to audition, to book and become Miles Morales was the original, oh my gosh, this would be amazing. But the project itself is like, ooh, I was blessed, look at this. No, seriously, beautiful animation.
I don't mean to maybe potentially pry, but I was told that as a kid, you actually had aspirations to be Spider-Man.
Most definitely.
What's the story behind that? A notebook?
I mean, oh yes. So this was a little later than my childhood. Everybody knows about Spider-Man.
You were a kid 2 years ago.
I still am a kid.
You're 23, you're a kid right now.
Yes, I still am a kid. I was filming Dope, and my co-star, Kiersey, she gave me this journal, and I started with, all of us were on this positive movement, the secret law of attraction and four agreements, all of that. And we're like reading books and listening to meditations and writing our thoughts down. What do we want? What are we attracting? And yeah, mine was the first thing on the first page was I am Miles Morales. And on the back of it was I am Spider-Man. And a whole bunch of other stuff is in that journal. But yeah, and 2 years later, boom, pow, boom, pow.
It works. You know? That's the way it works for Shamik. It does not work that way for me. I got a lot of stuff in my notebook, Phil.
Magic notebook.
Well, Jake, why don't you tell us a little bit about your Peter Parker?
Well, it's Peter Parker at 40. And it's Peter Parker with a bad back, and it's Peter Parker who's not sure if he still wants to be Spider-Man. Mm-hmm. And what it means to be, you know, what it means to be Spider-Man after the excitement of being Spider-Man. Mm-hmm. That just got really heavy, folks.
Yeah, it did.
But that's what, I mean, that's this Peter Parker.
Yeah.
It's chubby Peter Parker.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's hard. It's, you know, you run into that many kind of villains throughout your day-to-day life. I'm sure that takes a toll after a while.
That's right.
Yeah.
And then he meets Miles in this movie, and Miles needs him to be a mentor and needs things from him, but he doesn't see himself as a mentor or a teacher, and he doesn't want to be. But he sees something really special in this guy, and it reminds him of what he loves about having those powers.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad you brought that up then. Could you, either of you, explain the relationship between Peter and Miles? I mean, the fact that, you know, he is kind of a teacher, but a reluctant one, but also a friend. There's a lot of great banter back and forth that I saw.
I think, you know, there's two different perspectives, obviously, two different characters.
Totally.
But Miles just needs a teacher. He doesn't really want to be Spider-Man. He doesn't want this extra responsibility. You know, he's just trying to go to school like a normal kid, middle school. All of a sudden, he bit by this spider, and he got these powers, and now people are trying to kill him. And he has this duty of saving multiple universes. And now I meet this Spider-Man, and I'm like, hey, dude, you need to teach me.
No. I don't need to teach you.
Why not?
Go away, kid.
Dude, I really need you to help me save the world.
Not now. And I think Peter is...
And sing.
Just not now.
Not now, on your own time.
No, Miles. And I think Peter's in a situation where he sees this kid asking something from him and he doesn't want to give it to him. Mm-hmm. But he's so persistent. And anytime someone's really persistent, after a while, if you're any sort of a human, you break down and give in.
Well, Haley, let's go to talking about Gwen Stacy, a.k.a. Spider-Gwen. What excited you most to play her?
Ooh, well, first of all, I get to play a female superhero, which was pretty cool. And not just any female superhero, but the first Spider-Woman. I mean, that was so exciting to me, and the fact that she is really just the toughest and the coolest and the smartest and the most capable one in the room, and she knows it. There's something really incredible about her, and it was really
What? I just said sorry, guys.
Said sorry, guys.
Oh, right. I know. I got carried away there. The smartest, the toughest, the coolest, and what else? No, but she's got so much to her, and it was really fantastic playing a character like her.
And what's her relationship like with Peter and Miles as well?
Well, I had fun with this one. You know, it's always interesting too, really quickly, just the process of doing this and meeting you guys and mm-hmm. you know, not knowing you and knowing you through the process of doing this and sort of creating this these relationships, I guess at a distance. But Gwen has, I love the relationship that she has with Miles. It's kind of, how would you describe it?
Well, she's, you know, all of these characters are born out of tragedy on some level. And the thing that's interesting about intersecting their stories is for the first time there's somebody out there that knows what they're going through. And the thing that's so interesting to me about the relationship between, you know, Spider-Gwen and Miles and in our movie, all of these guys, is that they finally have like a tribe that they can hang out with. And here's somebody who like doesn't have a real a buddy and is almost afraid to have a friend.
Hey, lost a friend.
You know what I mean? And so the fact that like they kind of get to find each other is a really like beautiful part of the movie.
Bob, Peter, and Rodney, you guys have all these unique characters. You also have this unique style. How did you approach that? How did you bring breathe life into this entire world?
Well, as far as style, you know, a lot of it, you know, starts with Phil and Chris, you know, and this whole approach to the movie, which is that we're trying to push every aspect of this in a way that you haven't seen before, you know, and we're being challenged every day to think of ways to tell this story in a way that that you haven't seen before. And then as far as, you know, the characters, it really starts with the book, you know, like the heart of the book is Miles and his family and their relationship, and that's the heart of the movie.
Yeah, I think you know, the it's a really ambitious movie. It's probably the most ambitious thing about it is that it introduces a whole new version of Spider-Man. I mean, comics fans, you know, most of you guys, you've known Miles for a while, but the world at large doesn't really know him and doesn't really have experience of a different character kind of bearing this mantle. And the fascinating thing about it to me is that, you know, the same things that applied to Peter Parker, with great power comes great responsibility, those same ideas transfer onto another character who couldn't be more different than Peter in so many ways, and yet the strength of the original idea of the character still holds firm. It's still Spider-Man.
Anyone can wear the mask.
That is true. Yeah, I mean, I think what we're really trying to achieve too was just an interpretation of a comic book that actually made it on screen and felt cinematic, but still was beholden to the original source material, which was a comic printed on paper. And the process of making one of those, you know, you get these imperfections, and it's those imperfections that make that medium so special. And we were just looking to try to, you know, break the computer and bring some personality back to animation, which is, you know, one of the greatest mediums for personal expression out there. And it's kind of, you know, plateaued, and there's a certain expectation with animation, and we were looking to go beyond that. And in the same way that Miles is a different type of Spider-Man, we felt it was appropriate to find a new way to visualize it.
Where did you get the inspiration for this new approach?
I'm literally torn from the pages of the comics. I mean, awesome. 100%. And then it was just a matter of looking at, you know, the process that we go through to make these movies, and see how visually you could translate that flat medium into a three-dimensional space and project it and still feel, you know, the scope of a large film, but also the intimacy of the page and the panel on the page. And really, you know, one of the greatest strengths of comics is that it manages to encapsulate in one image a really succinct, powerful story point or motion or action. And in our process of animation, we really tried to achieve that same feeling.
That's awesome. So we know our core spider people, but Chris and Phil, let's talk a little bit about the Spider-Verse. How does that work? How does that play in?
How does that work?
Well,
you guys don't know.
Oh, we know.
Look, Miles' story takes place in an alternate dimension to our own. The Spider-Verse is basically, you know, all of these alternate ways of telling this story, and all of these different people that experience it, and the thought of this movie was, what if those different stories intersected? And what would it do? How would it shake them up? What would happen if these people met? And I think that's like the power of this character, is that we've told his story so many different ways. And like Shamik says, anyone can be behind that mask, and we can all imagine ourselves behind that mask. I think that's the cool thing about Spider-Man, and it's the interesting thing about comics culture and the fact that there's so many of these movies, that the story keeps getting told, and each time the differences and variations in the ways that it gets told, those are really interesting to us.
Awesome. All right, well, I know that everybody in the room is excited to see all of this in action. So do you guys have anything that you can show us? Even though we kind of guaranteed
do it. Do we have anything?
Do you have anything you can show us?
Yes, we do have. We brought some clips. They're not, some shots are not finished yet, so please watch it with an open mind. But we did say in the last trailer that save it for Comic-Con. And here we are at Comic-Con. So
it seems fitting
that we should unsave it now.
We have these amazing directors that are incredible, that put their heart and soul into what you're about to see, and we had to pry it out of their warm, alive hands to show it to you.
In an unfinished state, but here we go, let's check it out.
That was my first time watching that. I would just like to put that out there. That was amazing. Oh, man.
Yeah, that looks so good. The dialogue's on point. Everybody's funny. It's super charming. The art looks great. I'm just like super stoked for
this. Oh, man.
Yeah. And speaking of what we saw at the very end, how many spider people are there?
Well, we just met three new spider people. The first one you met was Spider-Man Noir, who is indeed voiced by Nick Cage. Then we had Penny Parker with her robot SPDR, voiced by Kimiko Glenn. And finally,
everybody seems to know Spider-Ham. Voiced by the incomparable John Mulaney.
He's definitely a scene stealer in the movie. So you should see it on the big screen, guys.
Well, it looks absolutely amazing. Thank you guys so much for sharing that with us here at Comic-Con. Big round of applause for our panelists, guys.
Thank you guys so much.